voice gets better and better and better, doesn't it? It gets stronger and stronger.
I hope so, I try. Yeah.
Are you still taking singing lessons and things?
I work with a coach. I work with different coaches. You get to a point where you know what the training is and then you go on to...
You practice every day?
Every day. Well, sometimes it depends how energetic I'm feeling. Sometimes I'm a bit lazy and say no.
How do you people manage to sing over sore throats? I keep reading, you know, so-and-so came on with a sore throat but sang over... How do you do that? How do you sing over a sore throat?
It depends what kind of sore throat it is. Sometimes you'll have a cold and you think, oh, I'll try and sing over it and it's fine. Mm. Sometimes it doesn't allow you to.
Yeah.
So you don't know how your voice is going to be from day to day. It's different.
Michael Crawford, who we chatted to about a year and a half, before he had his little accident, is he all right? Are you in touch with him? Is he all right? Is he...
I don't know. I'd heard something had happened, but
and
I
he's banged his hip.
Something to do with
hips. His hip.
Yes.
He can't do all the moves in his big show in Las Vegas. And he said that his muscular development, as he developed his voice, had grown. And basically his chest has got bigger. Has yours? I mean,
yes, No, what
singing
happens when you breathe, obviously your lung expansion is bigger and the ribs come out, and the more you do that, you're expanding. And I've had to change my size of clothes because that does happen. How exciting he goes.
Oh, no, I just wondered.
Extraordinary.
I thought it was good for Michael, it must be good for Sarah.
Right, enough of this subject. Yes. The extraordinary thing is that you're here at the moment because your very first hit, Starship Trooper, because it's hard to say, hard to sing. It has been re-released again because there's this movie out called Starship Troopers or something, which is going to be a great big sci-fi
big
picture. And although you're nothing to do with that picture, it's because of the song that you've now re-released it. Is that right?
Well, I haven't re-released it. I've nothing to
I'm
do with it.
I'm confused about this. Yeah.
Well, the song, as you know, was a big hit in the 70s. And I suppose when the film, some bright spark somewhere thought, ooh, Starship Troopers, Sarah Brightman, it's a cult record. Let's re-release it. So it's my old voice done in a new mix. I often find this. I find, you know, with operatic or classical things that I've recorded, I suddenly find I'm the sort of top of the dance charts in certain countries because they put new mixes in my voice and sampled it or whatever they do. So this often happens, but it's nothing to do with me, I promise.
You had this incredible hit. It was last year, I can't remember which month, it's Time to Say Goodbye with Andreas Bocelli. And it was number one in all over the world, actually. And it nearly got to number one here, but it stayed a long time at the top of the charts, didn't it? And it was riding up at number two for a long time. I think it's one of the nicest songs, one-off songs, that you've done, actually. I thought it was beautiful.
Thank you.
It really was. Were you pleased with it? Well, not the success, but the
yes,
tune.
Yes, I was, because, I mean, against all odds, it kind of made it through, because it's so difficult to get that kind of thing across to people. But it's been incredible. I mean, a few weeks ago I was in Taiwan, and that record went 5 times platinum in Taiwan, and all these different areas where you think it wouldn't get to people, and it's been like the world
over. Do you
remember
the first time you heard it, somebody said to you, hey, Sarah, listen to this, what do you think? Did you get a chance?
No, I heard it in a restaurant, in an Italian restaurant in Germany, yes.
Good heavens.
And I found out about it.
Well, on the Muzak sort of thing, you know. Sort of
your tapes that they play, yes. You know, you've had that and the Madonna and something else. Yeah, yeah. And
was it Andreas singing it? Was it his solo version?
Yes, and he'd had it out for about, I don't know, 2-3 years, and it hadn't done anything anywhere. Mm. And it just needed work on it, and it needed the right, you know, production on it, and to get it across on the right TV and work done with it.
What's it about? What's the story to the song?
It is obviously about two people's love and wanting to go off with each other and going, really, leaving the past behind and going on to new horizons. The lyrics are actually quite arty, and actually when you look at them in English they don't make lots of sense, but if you look at it overall it does.
Yeah.
Yes.
Impressionist.
Yes, yes, it is.
Yeah. You live in Germany now, don't you, with your...
Well, some of the time in Germany, the rest of the time is travelling about. I have a small place in Italy as well, so...
But I've been reading this very, very wonderful story about how you got to be listened to and taken notice of in Germany. Is this true, that you thought, right, the boxing is big, and we need to find a boxer who needs a good song to come onto? Is this correct?
It wasn't my idea. Uh-huh. The idea was put to me, only in that two producers I happened to be working on an album with, they were asked if they'd do a song for a boxing fight for the boxer's theme tune, as they often use. Mm. And they said, well, and we know somebody who would be perfect for it because she did the Barcelona Games with Carreras.
Yes.
Asked me if I would do it. And I said, okay. So we put this very operatic thing together, and a few weeks later I went on. And that was my first big hit
there. You didn't stand in the boxing ring though, did you?
Not well. They wouldn't let me, so they lifted me above the boxing ring, and I had a 22-foot dress on, which then, it was quite, I mean, it was quite bizarre, as often as those continental European things can be. But it just took the whole of Germany and all these surrounding area countries completely by storm.
Trilling away above.
It was like, I suppose it was a kind of mixture of modern opera and a kind of thing you think see in a Pink Floyd stadium, for example. So it was a mixture.
Brilliant.
But it worked. It was a real...
I get the impression that over the last maybe 5 to 10 years, you've kind of settled in the sense that you're having fun with your career, aren't you? I mean, you don't need to prove anything anymore.
Well, I don't. I think you always need to inside yourself prove. But
like what? What do you need to prove?
I don't know.
You sing well. I know. Success. You sell records.
Pleasing yourself, I suppose. Is that
And actually, singing a lot of it is to do with giving to people. And when you give on stage, obviously it's nice to be nicely received for that. So you're always pushing to yourself to become better and better and better and to give more.
And what's also nice to see as well over the years, we always mention this when you come on, because it's worth mentioning, that you've built a very nice friendly relationship with your ex, you know,
with Andrew.
Mr. Weber with Andrew. In fact, I came to see you on the 10th anniversary performance of Phantom. Do you remember when you came on afterwards with him? And he played the piano and you sang some songs. It was lovely. But you haven't had to work at that too much, have you? You are naturally quite good pals, you know.
We always have been.
Always have been.
And we get on very well. We have the same taste in music. You know, we're just two souls that get on well, which is carrying through, which is great.
Well, we can see you with them here, actually. This is what you're here to talk about, actually.
Yes.
This concert at the Albert Hall that you did and was videoed and all the rest of it. So I really wanted to come to, but I couldn't. Here's a clip of you with him.
Okay.
He looks at you with real pride, doesn't he?
I don't know.
He does.
Yes, he's a sweet man. He's a nice man.
Clearly worked together very well on a good level.
Have you called him Sir Andrew yet? You must have called him.
I think we've had a few jokes about it. Him in his Ermine cloak. He's got a photo of it somewhere.
Excellent.
He has a good sense of humour about it.
What's the album called?
Which album?
The Victoria, the Albert Hall album.
It's Sarah Brightman in concert. And this was really exciting because you know how often, many times in shows that I've done, I've gone out and done my best performance in maybe a matinee performance which has had sort of 10 people who think, oh God, I wish I could get that on film.
Yeah.
And there really hasn't been any footage of me anywhere. And fans have always said, can't we have a video? Or if they can't get to the concert. So we filmed this video of a live performance at the Albert Hall, which for me was, although having travelled around the world and gone to so many wonderful venues, the Albert Hall for me is my home. Yeah. It was amazing. And getting out there, I was thinking, oh my God, this is it. And I had to really get it together. And we filmed it.
I had a taste of that myself. You know, two Christmases ago, Julie and I were asked to go to a carol concert at the Albert Hall. And we had to all we had to do was introduce a carol. We came out, told a joke, and got off. Was best 2 minutes of my life that year, just
Isn't
to go into the middle of the Albert Hall and you kid yourself, I am playing the Albert Hall.
I know, it just has such a wonderful feeling around it and all the history behind it, and it is our home, you see, so it's very important.
It's London's Village Hall, that's what they call it. London's Village
Hall. Oh really, I didn't know that.
Lovely.
Yeah.
It does everything, the jamborees and everything.
Absolutely,
Trust us to be understated.
Yeah, good,
there's a car boot sale there on Saturday if you can't get along. So good luck with it. Lovely to see you. Anything else we need to mention? Have we mentioned everything?
I think so, the video, everything.
Except for the fact
I missed the big diamond, though. Look at that sparkling away.
Ooh, cool diamond.
Wow. Oh, maybe it's not real.
No, it's just a bit of old glass. I don't think so.
Beautiful.
Isn't that lovely?
And we are playing the whole of Time to Say Goodbye as you sang it here with Andres. Yep, Andreas?
Right. It's all right.
About 6 months ago. It's beautiful. You'll love it. That's at the end of the show, the whole version. But we'll take a break now. We're back in 2 minutes with a phone and on Families at War. We've got psychiatry. I'm afraid you have to do
that. Oh, you've done brilliantly. I think she deserves a round of applause.
You too.
This is again from Anne Summers. It's PVC bra and knickers, $19.99 the bra, $11.99 the knickers. Why did you choose them?
Well, I've never told a man this. I've always had something for Catwoman. Yeah. And I saw her wearing this in a film, and I thought, right. It's something for the weekend as well. It's it's a treat for me. I don't think I was thinking of perhaps, regular everyday wear, but something
Well, G-strings are an invention of the devil, aren't they?
Oh, dreadful. And the thing is that they would also get sweaty as well, so you want every bit of...
Let the poor girl go.
Brilliantly, thank you.
And this is Amanda's choice. Modeled by Emma.
Oh, this is nice.
Oh, that's very pretty.
And this is from Licenza. £29 for the bra, £12 for knickers. And the nice thing about it, you get nice uplift. It's more like a Wonder Bra, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. You need it, especially, I mean, I've had a baby, so you need that uplift with the bra, and I think it's just very chic and pretty.
It's very
and
it's very
classy.
Very
nice. It is classy.
So do all the guys like this?
Yeah, nice. Actually, it's very nice.
So pretty, feminine, good.
Yeah. So we do agree on one
ten
set that we all like together.
Not something for the weekend.
Yeah, that's lovely. Yeah. Very good.
Thank you very much. Yeah. All the girls here, though. I mean, right. You said that most of what the guys picked was uncomfortable. Yeah. But would you wear it in the bedroom?
No, I certainly would. Definitely wouldn't wear it.
Solo sogno l'orizzonte, mancano le parole. Sì, lo so che non c'è luce in una stanza quando manca il sole. Se non ci sei tu con me su. Le finestre mostrare tutto il mio cuore che è acceso. Chiudi dentro me la luce che ho incontrato per strada. Sogno all'orizzonte, manca le parole. E io sì lo so che sei con me, tu mia luna, tu sei qui con me. Mio sole, tu sei qui con me, con me, con me, con me. Time.